it's on. Okay. Yeah, it's on. Cool. Hello, everyone. My name is Haoyi, and this talk is going to be about exploring Singapore's open data APIs. So a bit about myself. So I was previously a software engineer at Dropbox working on internal tools. Currently, I'm at Bright Technology Services, which is a small software and data science consultancy in Singapore. So if any of you have software projects that need extra hands or data analysis that, or insights that need to happen, you can come look for us after and we'll see if we can take on your project. And that's my Twitter handle, GitHub, and I have a blog at lihaoyi.com. So that's enough about myself. About this talk. This talk was originally a blog post on my blog, and it's going to be about open data. So open data is the idea that you have data that's freely available for anyone to use without any sort of strings attached, without any contract that needs to be signed, or without any agreement or partnership that needs to happen. So I assume most people here are doing some sort of kind of data science job. So who here is doing some kind of data science job? Who here makes use of publicly available APIs as part of their job? So part of the nice things about open data is that you can immediately use the public APIs without needing to, for example, make an agreement within you and the other company. And that lets the data be used by many more people, maybe students, maybe individuals, maybe small startups, which would not be able to sign a contract with a large multinational or with the Singapore government. So I'm not affiliated with any of the organizations whose open data I'm showing, but I'm just an enthusiast who happens to have used some of them, and I'll show off the things that you can build using them. So the Singapore government has a bunch of open data providers. They are somewhat disparate. So you have data.gov.sg, you have the LTA, which does public transport and other transport data. You have things like the library board, the NEA, giving your PSI for how much haze there is. Things like the URI data service for telling you what the prices on condos are getting sold in each area. So there isn't any real consolidated list of open data providers in Singapore, and this list is also not complete. But from this, there's already a lot of interesting things you can explore and do with this data. So for example, this has a whole range from not very interesting reports that get published once a year. So this is open data and that's public, but it's not really something that's interesting to a developer or programmer. To you have small data lists, data sets, like this comes in an Excel spreadsheet, which tells you how many people are in each ministry in Singapore every year. Again, not particularly interesting. You have live data, which starts getting more interesting. For example, if you want your app to make use of the current Singapore weather, the Singapore NEA National Environment Agency has an open API which can use to query the weather forecast for next 4 hours, next 24 hours, what the PM 2.5 is, that sort of thing. And you have LTA exposing the list of every arrow that exists on every road in Singapore, or every convex mirror that exists in Singapore. You know, those convex mirrors they put around corners so you don't crash into cars going the other way. So they have this huge data set of every single one in Singapore. And if you need it, you can download it. In addition, they also have the real-time APIs, which I think are personally the most interesting. So for example, you can query what are the bus arrival times for any bus at any bus stop in Singapore in terms of given a particular time, when is the next bus going to arrive at this bus stop, when's the next bus going to arrive at this bus stop. And that's a data set that all the apps, for example, like bus.sg or mytransport.sg, these are data sources that those apps use. So, so in this short demo, I'm going to show off a few things you can make using open data. So one of them is how to make a bus timing board. So all of you have probably seen these boards available at the more popular bus stops, telling you when the next bus of each service is going to arrive at bus stop, when the next bus is going to arrive, and whether it's disabled friendly or not with the wheelchair symbol. I'm going to show you how to make a bus trip planner using the data that's available to tell you, given I want to go from one bus stop to another bus stop, which bus stops do I have to go through along the way to transfer, and which bus services should I take to for example, minimize the number of transfers or minimize the number of bus stops or some function of those. And lastly, I'm going to show you how to make a taxi heat map. So who here has seen one of these visualizations that shows you where all the taxis are in Singapore? Has anyone seen these? So it shows that red means a lot of taxis at Changi Airport, there's some in the CBD, there are no taxis in Lim Chu Kang. So if you live there, then too bad. So I'm going to show you how to make one of these in next hour or so using the open data that's available. So all the code for this presentation is available on this GitHub repo. So if any of you want to follow along or later you want to come back and revisit the code and try running it yourself, it's all up there in a form that you can easily dump into your Python interpreter and run. So to begin with, let's look at how to make a bus timing monitor like that. So we won't have any hardware or any fancy UI, but I'll show you how to get the core of getting the data out and manipulating it and presenting it in a reasonable way. So this bus timing data is available at the LTA data mall. So my transport SG content data mall. If you Google LTA data mall, it'll bring you here. So this is a somewhat old looking site that contains both static data. For example, this is all the geospatial data I showed you earlier about, for example, where the roads are in Singapore, where the road crossings are. If you want to make your own model of Singapore road network, the data is here for you to use, as well as real-time dynamic data. So for the dynamic data, you have to request through their API that's updated, say, once a minute, once every 5 minutes. You first have to request API access to get it, but this is more formality than an actual requirement. So you just put in a name, email, and they'll send you your access code. And as far as I know, the main purpose is so that if you start doing weird things with API or start overloading them, they'll know who to contact to see how they can work it out. So if you make like 10 million requests a day to the API and the server start falling down, they can phone you up and tell you to back off. And the documentation for the API, which perhaps the most interesting, only available as a PDF document. I'm not sure why, but despite only being a PDF document, it has everything you'd expect in a nice setup API docs. So if you look through, they have a changelog, which is more than most startups have in the API docs. And they have a nice listing of all the different APIs they have available. So for example, you can look at when the bus arrival times are. So they have some examples. For example, let's see if we can make this bigger. If you request data mall, my transfer SG, LTA, or data service, bus arrival, pass in the bus stop number as a query param, you will get a JSON blob back that shows you all the buses which are going to arrive at that stop and metadata about them. For example, in this case it says service number 15 is estimated arrival at this time, currently it's at latitude, longitude, in case you want to show it on some map or visualization. And it shows you the next subsequent bus that's going to arrive. And it does this for all the different services that will arrive at that particular bus stop. Similarly, LTA also provides data for all sorts of random things, like it provides an API for showing traffic incidents, so where are the traffic incidents in Singapore if you want to put them on the map. Or it has API for showing roadworks, so if you have an app like Waze, for example, I'm going to show, given your traffic route, where are the things that are along the way that may affect you. These are the APIs that give you easy access to those things. So that's enough talking about it. So let's look at some code. I'll put this down a second. Let's format this nicely, make this a bit bigger so people can see it. Can you guys at the back see this? Yeah? Okay, cool. So this is a standard IPython REPL. So if any of you want to follow along, it's IPython using Python 3. The first thing I'm going to do is to load my LTA key, which I had requested earlier. And immediately, you can start making requests, and you can start, you can import requests, and you can start making requests to the LTA data service. So for example, this pulls down the data for the traffic incidents, which are ongoing in Singapore. And you can see that you get a bunch of JSON, which is slightly hard to read. And if you want to, you can explore it using a standard Python tools. For example, I know that it's a dictionary. I know that it has particular keys. And using those keys, I can dig further into it, see what it is, and get some interesting insights. For example, I can see the length of the list is now 22. So there are 22 ongoing traffic incidents. For example, heavy traffic on PIE towards Tuas, heavy traffic on Adam Road, so on and so forth. So you only really need 4 or 5 lines of code to get started with this data. And from then on, it's up to you what you want to do with it. So as mentioned earlier, we are going to make a bus timing monitor. So the API that interests us the most is probably the bus arrival API. So let's see. I guess before we do bus arrival, one thing that would be nice is to get bus stops. So this is a request that will pull down the bus stops, the list of bus stops that are available in Singapore. It similarly has it wrapped in a value thing that you can pull out. And you see, it only gives you 50 bus stops. And that's because, as you may have seen, there's a skip parameter that you can pass in that will let you get a next 50, a next 50, a next 50. So if I pass it in with skip, so currently the last bus stop it showed I got back is the Nicoll Highway, is One Raffles Link along Nicoll Highway. And if I pass in with skip, I get Cathedral of the Good Shepherd along Victoria Street. And if I want to, I can write a small function that will fetch all this stuff for me, because it's not difficult to make multiple, have a while loop that makes multiple requests until you get all your data you want. So in this case, we start with no output. We fetch it given a skip parameter, which is this the length of the output. So if you have 58 results or we have 100 results, I skip the first 100 and ask for the next 50. And then we keep fetching until the length of the output is zero, and that's when we know there's no more results, and we can return the whole output as the return value. So with this, you can easily pull down, for example, all bus stops, and you still pull it down 50 at a time. For this particular data set of bus stops, it doesn't really matter how up-to-date it is, because the bus stops don't change every minute or change every hour. So for this, you probably want to pull it down and cache it so you don't need to keep hitting their servers over and over. And now we can see that all bus stops, we have all 4,859 bus stops. Each bus stop has, let's look at the first one, for example. Each bus stop has a bus stop code, which you've probably seen on the bus stop pole, the description, Hotel Grand Pacific, lat and long in Singapore, and the road name. So if you want to, if this is helpful because many of the other APIs will require the bus stop code. For example, if you want to find out the bus stops which are along Orchard Road, we can say something like stop for stop in all stops if stop road name equals Orchard Road. Is that right? That's not right. Oh, I misspelled Orchard. Bah. Or card. Orchard Road. There we go. So we can ask for, say, only the descriptions. Oh, sorry, singular description. So these are the bus stops which are along Orchard Road. And if you want a particular bus stop, for example, we may want op. We want the ones whose description is op Orchard Station, and get its, oops. And you can get its bus stop code. So that's how you can do basic things with the data you get from the LTA Data Mall API. And this will come in useful later when we need to use the bus stop ID in order to ask LTA for the data about a particular bus stop. So now we have a list of all bus stops. We can write a function to help us search for bus stops quite easily. So I can find the stop, which is Orchard Station, I could find a stop which is YMCA, for example, or find the multiple stops which are related to auto station or related to YMCA. And then after that, it's a matter of making a separate API request. Let's make this bigger. It's a matter of making a separate API request to the bus arrival API, passing in the bus stop code as a parameter. So for example, if I go back here, let's say I want the YMCA bus stop. I can fetch, this depends on this helper function I defined earlier. So let's define, let's pull that in to, so I don't need to keep writing request.get headers blah. And then it's a matter of fetching the data for, in this case, the YMCA bus stop whose ID we found earlier. So again, this is somewhat long. We can shorten it to say, what's in this data? We can see that there, it says there are three elements. It is a dictionary. It has the same, it has the bus stop ID, OData metadata, which maybe we don't care about for now, and a services key. So the services probably contains what we want. So now we can pull out the services, see how many there are. See, 29 of them. Let's assign this YMCA buses. Equals that, YMCA buses. You can look at one service to see what kind of data it gives us. So in this case, you can see that this is service number 106, and next arrival time is this in UTC, which we can convert to Singapore time in a moment. And it shows you the subsequent arrival, and for the subsequent arrival, it just doesn't give you data. So this is a relatively common thing in these open data APIs where some of the data is either wrong or missing and you just have to deal with it as a consumer. Okay, so one thing that we could do is we could define a function that would prettify the time, the UTC time, into something that's more reasonable. For example, giving us the time in minutes from now, which is the same thing that they show on those big bus stop arrival boards. So you could do this using a third-party library. For example, PyTZ is popular, Arrow is popular. But for now, I'm going to avoid using those libraries and just use the default Python with some string mangling and regexes. So you can paste this into the console. And you can define a function that will, given a bus stop description, find the, do I have find stop already? Back here. Define a function that given a bus stop description, it'll find the bus stops which match the description and pull down their data for you using the bus arrival time endpoint, passed with a bus stop code, and it'll give you the service number and the next bus arrival time. So for now, let's just ignore the subsequent buses, the next bus and next bus. So I can say bus timings for, let's say, opposite Orchard Station. And you can see that we get 106, 101, 123, 114, 16. All with the hard-to-read UTC timestamps. And we can feed it through. We can feed it through a simple for comprehension to prettify all the timestamps using this narrowly function that we defined earlier that converts into a relative time. And you feed it in, and you get out a nice list of all the next bus arrival times in opposite Orchard Station, which I think is along Orchard Boulevard in Orchard, Singapore. So it looks mostly correct. Some data is missing because the night rider buses aren't running at the time and right now, and these other buses maybe are not running at this time either. Some data looks a bit weird. 16 seems to be arriving in a very long time from now. So again, some data is going to be broken and you just have to deal with it and maybe ignore it when you're displaying it to your users or ignore it when taking into, when trying to do your computations. But other than that, you can see that, well, 65 is arriving right now. 106 will have to wait another 11 minutes. 123 will have to wait another 13 minutes, and so on. So we can feed this into other stations. For example, feed this into the YMCA station. And YMCA. Which has a lot more buses, both buses which are running and buses which are not running, and buses which are going to arrive in a long, long time from now. And that's all you really need to get a simple bus arrival time monitor using the APIs that LTA provides. So this doesn't show you how to put it on a pretty website or put it on a hardware LED display screen or put it on a mobile app. But the core of what you need to get these APIs is on the order of a few dozen lines of code to perform the fetch the bus arrival endpoint in order to get your data down. Then after that, it's trivial to just mangle it in Python to display it however you wish to display it. So that's the first demo, the making a bus arrival time display. It's in the terminal and not on a board at the bus stop, but functionally you can kind of say it's the same, more or less. The next demo will be making a bus trip planner. So we'll use the same data set for this as we did for the previous one. And the goal of this is to say, given I'm at bus stop 1 and want to get to bus stop 2, what bus stops do I have to stop along the way and what bus services do I have to take to transfer at those bus stops in order to get to my destination? So the data for this is available in a different endpoint. Let's pull it out. The data to do this will be available at a different endpoint called bus routes. So bus routes, you basically have to make an endpoint to this underscore bus to this bus routes API, which I can show you. If I ask for fetch. So bus routes. You don't need to pass in a bus stop ID for this endpoint. Let's call this routes. So let's see what this is. Again, routes is a dictionary. Interesting things seem to be in this value parameter. Inside value, we have a list of 50. That's 50 things that look like this. So this tells you that each item says at this bus stop, one in this case 14141, we have SMRT bus number S-S49 stopping in its first stop in the sequence. So it's not a lot of information, it just tells you the single stop. And if you look at element 1, element 2, element 3, you can see every single element just says a single bus stop is stopped at by a single bus service in the whole of Singapore. So although it is not in a convenient format, we can aggregate this data and fetch all of it rather than having just 50 elements. So we fetch all bus routes. Let's call this all route stops. You can see that it has to make a lot of fetches again because this data set includes one item for every bus which stopping at every bus stop. So this will give it another 20 seconds or so to put it all down. Again, this is something that you probably don't need to refresh often because the bus routes don't change very often. So maybe pull it, if you want to use it, pull it down once a day or once a week, it's probably fine. I remember correctly, it's something like 20,000 data points. So this is how you end up making 5 million requests a day to the API and getting a call to back off. If you keep doing this, they will find you and tell you to stop. Come on. Just give it a moment.
Is there any limit that they tell you, maximum?
So they told me to try and keep it below like 2 or 3 million a day. But there isn't any hard limit. Like some services will rate limit you automatically. For them, they don't. And I think it's kind of manual. Someone will notice this thing going up and they'll find out who's doing it. I don't think the 3 million a day was really a hard limit either. If everyone starts using 3 million, they'll probably also start getting unhappy. Okay, so we are done. That only took 4,400 network requests. And you can see all route stops now has a huge list of every bus stopping at every bus stop in Singapore. So again, this is not a very useful data structure, but it contains all the data we need in order to find out which buses can go to which, from can take me from what bus stop to another bus stop. So let's go back here. So I wrote some code that I guess I won't explain in too much detail due to time. But the first snippet converts this format of every bus and every route, every bus and every stop, into a, let's see, let me see if in dot keys, keys, let's say import pprint.pprint all routes dot keys. Mister. Well, it's not that useful. But this basically the keys to this dictionary are, if I take an example, a tuple of the bus service number or ID, for example 970 or NR2 or something else, as well as a bus direction, because some buses go two directions, and the ones going the so-called backwards direction are represented by two in the direction number. So presumably there's a 38 one, which is a bus 38 going outwards from the stop, from the terminal, and there's a bus 38-2, which is the 38 coming backwards, and both do different routes. So for each of these routes, we can now ask, for example, given bus 38 in the backwards direction, you can now ask which bus stops are the bus stops along that route. So this is a slightly more useful data structure to see, given a bus stop, which routes can get me to which other bus stops, which is what I'll need for the pathfinding algorithm. Next step would be to create a dictionary which tells me which bus stops can take me to what other bus stops directly, to what routes. So in this case, we had which routes had which bus stops. Now I want to know which bus stops can take me to which other bus stops. So if you do that, all stop connections. Come on. So if you look at, for example, stop number 49071, this data structure tells me there's only one bus coming out of stop number 49071, and that's bus number 925. And bus number 925 will bring me to the following bus stops. So now that we have the data structure that lets us look up how to get from any one bus stop to any other bus stop, you can then use that to calculate how to get from any bus stop indirectly to any other bus stop that you may require one or two or three transfers. So that is done using a breadth. If we only care about number of transfers and don't care about other things like distance or other weightages, number of stops, this can be done simply using a breadth first search. So I have a breadth first search here, which people may have learned in school. So who here has written a breadth first search before? So some fraction of you have written breadth first searches before. So it's basically our intro computer science intercomputer science algorithm problem. You have a queue, you put in your starting ID, and every time you have a while loop until the queue is empty, you pull out the thing at the top of the queue, see what it can connect to, and take all those and put them back in the queue. So this lets you gradually expand the set of bus stops you can see until you hit the one you want, in which case you stop and see how did you get to that, how did you get there. So again, this is, I'm not going to explain the code in total due to time, but it's not a lot of code and you can browse it on GitHub, as I mentioned earlier. So for example, you now define this function. So if you look for the, let's see. So if you want to look for the bus stop, the bus route, for example, from opposite Orchard Station, which is along Orchard Boulevard, to Anglo-Chinese School, which is where I used to study, you see that opposite Orchard Station is a bus code 09022. Anglo-Chinese School has a bus code 40069. So we can feed that into our, we can feed that into our breakfast search. And you can see that this will tell you to take bus number 174 to Tulip Garden, and after that, take bus number 48 to Anglo-Chinese School, starting at opposite Orchard Station. And if we don't trust this, because there's no reason to believe that it's actually correct, since I just put it here, we can verify it manually, for example, going on the LTA bus website. So if you look at LTA bus, what is it, 174, is this one it? Bus 174. Okay, this should be it. So, this is opposite Orchard Station 9022, and then it takes you to Tulip Garden down here. And if you then look at bus route number 48, which we can look at 48. Tulip. You can see it takes you from Tulip Garden up here to Anglo-Chinese School down here. So this is a bit of a manual verification. You can do more fancy things if you want. But this shows that this is a valid route to get from opposite Orchard Station to Anglo-Chinese School. Again, this is a relatively naive algorithm. So because it does a breakfast search and doesn't take into account things like number of bus stops it takes to get from one transfer to next transfer, it doesn't take into account things like how the distance between the bus stops, which are all actually available in the LTA API. It only finds a route to minimize the number of transfers, and that route may not be ideal. But if you want to write this yourself and spend another 30 minutes or 1 hour converting into a Dijkstra's algorithm in order so you can take care of the, you can take into account these extra features or weightages, you can then weight it however you want. For example, finding a route that would minimize the number of bus stops along the way, plus mean number of transfers times some multiple, or find a route that minimizes the distance traveled, regardless of how many bus stops or how many transfers you have to take. So another example you could see, say if you want to find the route from Boon Lay, let's say Boon Lay CC, which is 21439, to Changi Airport stop, like 95011. We can plug those in, 21439, 95011. And you see it gives us a route from Boon Lay CC to Boon Lay Interchange to after Tomlinson Road to Changi Airport. And if you want, you can go verify this yourself on the bus website. I won't do this right now. Cool. So that is the second demo. So that is making a bus trip planner using the open data that's available in the LTA API. Not quite as pretty as the thing you see in Google Maps, but functionally somewhat similar. The last demo I'll show off is making one of these fancy taxi density visualizations. which let you see like, oh, where are all the taxis in Singapore? There's a whole bunch at Changi, there's a few at Orchard, a few at Kallang, and so on and so forth. So I'm going to use data.gov API instead of LTA API for this. But in practice, it's about the same data that you can get from both sources. So the data.gov API looks like this. So you also have to register to get the account API key separate from your LTA API key, and separate from any other API key you have to sign up for in the government. And this lets you make a single API request to say taxi availability, which doesn't say here, but we'll get you the lat-long locations of all the taxis in Singapore. And I can show it to you now in a moment. So if you go back here, let's go to taxi.py, which has my demo for this. First thing is to pull up the data.gov API key, pull in the taxi requests using, you need to pass in a date time, so they include historic, they let you query historical data as well. So you can pass in the arbitrary date time of when you want to query. This is a few hours ago. And you need to pass in API key. And you run that, and you see taxis gets you a huge pile of lat and longs. So this doesn't have as much metadata as the buses. It doesn't tell you which taxi is driven by which person or what their license plate number is or how long it's been since the last break. But it gives you enough to draw the fancy map we showed earlier. So you can pull out the data relatively easily. So I believe it's under features. Tick not dot key. Taxis features. I guess there's only one feature, maybe. There's only one feature. Dot keys. Then I want to look at, I guess, like the geometry. What is this? Coordinates. And now you get a list of basically tuples of the lat long of every taxi in Singapore. So let's see what I was going to do for that. So if you want to make a visualization like what we have here, the first thing to do is probably to find out what's the bounding box of, like, what's the maximum latitude, maximum longitude, minimum longitude for like the rectangle of the world that we care about that has these taxis inside. So since we know the data is a list of tuples, it's a matter of two for comprehension to pull out the max and the min, or a single for loop to pull out the max min of both x and y all at the same time. So let's do that. So this loops over everything, pulls out the max x, min x, max y, min y. Min x, for example. And from there, we can then put the taxis into buckets that we can then put onto a map. So let's assume I want the buckets with a map that's 40 buckets wide. Then how high would that map be? Since we know the max x and min x, it's a matter of doing a bit of arithmetic to find the ratio of the difference between max x, min x, max y, min y, and use that to calculate how many buckets high our map should be. So given a width of 40, it says we should have 23 buckets tall. Okay? We can initialize a grid to have a bunch. We can initialize a grid to have all these buckets. So there are 24 buckets, and there are 24 rows of buckets, and each row of buckets has 41 buckets in it. Then we can take the taxis and take each data point and chuck them into a bucket using the x and y. So we take the difference from the x and the min x, and the difference from y and the min y, and we find which bucket the taxi should be. So instead of having latitude from 1.03 to 1.05, you then get a number from 0 to 23, for example. And now you get, you get a grid, which is still not very interesting, at least not like this. if I print it out nicely, let's give myself a bit more space. Yeah, you can kind of see that it's a map of Singapore, right? So you can see the whole bunch of zeros in the central catchment area. You can see there's like two taxis in Lim Chu Kang. Not sure who you're picking up. Hopefully not the ghosts. You can see the whole bunch of taxis in Changi Airport, 286 and 410 taxis there. So this is itself not very pretty, but we can pretty it up with not too much difficulty. The first is, I guess, to remove the zeros. So for n in row dot join, what's this doing? Right justify for n in row. So I'm just going to have if n equals 0 else that. So that gets rid of all the zeros. And now it's a lot quite clearly what it is. You can quite clearly see all the outliers, like this person Tuas, this person Jurong Island, those two people Jurong Island, so on. The next step would be to try and add some color, because one of the reasons why this thing is so easy to read is because immediately you can see where the red spots, the blue spots, the green spots are. So to do that, so I defined a small function here that uses nz colors to color the output of the, to color the number of taxis in each cell. So simple color, let me think a bit. So in order to color the cells reasonably, we'd want to color the cells based on their, let me show it off again. We'd want to color the cells based on their percentile rather than based on their value. Because, for example, the bigger cell, cell number 400, is so big that even half of that, even half of 400 is still more than almost any other cell in the map. And so if you color it by value, like for example, 10% of max, 20% of max, 30% of max, you won't get any reasonable numbers out of it. We won't get reasonable colors out of it. So this is a small snippet of code that colors that will tell us the percentile of each cell. So if I went for the rankings and ask it, what is percentile for a cell with 37? It tells us it's in the 95th percentile, more or less. And now, using a slightly more complex for loop, W is not defined. I need to move these out. That's not right. Okay. Let's move these out and put them outside. And if I run this, we can see we get a slightly more colorful rough map of what the taxis in Singapore look like. And you can see all the deep blues where there are almost no taxis, the blacks where there are totally no taxis, and the reds where there are higher densities. The last part of the demo is to use a slightly more fine grain coloring. So Bash lets you do 8 colors like this, lets you do 16 colors. Most modern terminals also let you do 256 and 65k colors in the terminal using different escape codes. So these 8 colors were done using these /033(31M) escape codes, which you can find if you go Google ANSI escape codes. I defined a set that uses the, I believe, 216 color escape codes, which are a bit complicated to explain here. But if we run it using the 216 color escape codes, you'll see we get a much more colorful map of where things are. So you can see quite clearly that the CBD and Changi Airport are the most popular places for taxis to hang out. And you can see that the gradient drops off, so the greens and yellows have fewer and fewer, the oranges have even fewer, and eventually end up with these dark blues and purples, which have barely any taxis at all. So that's the last demo for this presentation. So these are three things we built. They don't look quite as pretty as the one on the left, but on your right. but they kind of do the same thing. They pull out the data, they let you explore it, and they let you visualize it and get the same information you have in a slightly different format. Those are the open data APIs that are available. Those are some of the open data APIs that are available. There are some limitations, as you've seen already. Like, it's messy to have to go dig through different PDF documents to find out how to use API endpoints, to sign up for three different API keys at three different government agencies. The accuracy of the data is also sometimes questionable. Like, bus number 7 probably wasn't going to take 1,400 minutes to arrive the next time, but these glitches in data do appear and you have to handle them. And similarly, the availability of the data is not always what you want. So sometimes the data you want just isn't publicly available in the API, and that's just too bad. But on the bright side, you could make three quite neat demos of pretty useful tools that people use day to day using open data APIs in 40 minutes and about 100, 200 lines of code. So if any of you want to go and look at the code, again, it's all on GitHub. So if you go to GitHub, Li Haoyi, open data, you'll see there's a bus demo online with all the code you can copy and paste into your own IPython console. And there's a taxi demo also with all the code you can copy and paste into your own IPython console. So you can try it yourself. And I guess that's it. So that's the presentation exploring Singapore's open data APIs. Yeah. So again, I have to pitch Bright Technology Services. So if any of you have data science work that needs to be analyses that need to happen, or software engineering work needs to be done, we can pick up projects, or I can talk to you, see if it's something that we can handle. My email's here if any of you want to contact me later, and the data's there if any of you want to go and try this yourself or modify it or build upon it. Do you have time for questions?
Yes, sir.
Going once, going twice. Go for it.
When I look at the GoDare.sg, they can calculate the price, but the API doesn't give us the price. So how do you think they calculate?
I don't know. I assume it's a simple enough model that you can figure it out and hard code it once and not have to change it too often. But I don't actually know what they did. But for something like the bus pricing, if it doesn't change more than once every few months, it's something that you can have someone figure out each time and just code in. Yeah, I don't actually know what they do, if that's actually what they do. Yeah. Any other questions? Cool, I guess we are done. Thank you.
Thank you.